Definitely a great win all around, but I think our team took a big step forward in the run game. One big thing is to stop the run every game, and I think that's what we did, and I think that was a big key to our W that game. But yeah, it was a good win, and we're ready for this upcoming week.
So, was it just doing everybody doing their jobs better, or did you have a new attitude,
the plan going into this week was something we've never done before. It's actually very simple. We didn't do too much, and I think that's what made us play better. We did the plays that we knew we could execute, and our DC felt good with it, and we executed them well.
Afterwards, Quinn was of course really excited.
Yeah,
I mean, you have enough family ties to BYU that do you think the game meant a little bit more to some of you guys like that?
Yeah,
maybe some of these other guys don't have
sure.
ties.
For sure, especially Quinn. You know, he coming from BYU, that guy was going crazy after we won. But my brother, I'm happy that we beat them just because of him. And what he's been through with BYU, I mean, I'm not a big fan. I mean, I actually was a fan before I got here, but once I put on the Aggie blue, that went out the window.
Chris, I mean, you guys held him before that last drive. Man, I think 14 rushing yards.
You yeah.
played in a game that the defense was so dominant like that on the run game?
I haven't. This is the first time when they put up the stats on the board, it blew my mind. I was running up the sideline, looking at everybody, telling them, hey, check this out, 14 yards. A big game for our defense for sure.
Clear, you guys are much improved against the run this year, and you'll have another chance to prove it this week. Lexington Tom, my goodness, had a good game against you guys last year. So how excited are you to get another shot at him this weekend?
Oh, definitely a new year, ready to show him that it's not the same team that he played last year for sure.
What's the big difference between last year and this year? Is it mostly Coach Patterson coming in and instilling a new attitude? Is it, just more skilled players?
That's one of the keys for sure. KP coming in, and that vibe that he brings is definitely different. But I think it's experience. Last year, I think we had a very young team. But this year, everybody's comfortable with each other, and I think we know what we're doing out there.
With it being homecoming week, do you have other activities that you are required to participate in, or is it just all focused on football, or do you have to be like in the parade or something?
For all I know, it's just another week.
Yeah. Fair enough.
You UNLV is in a situation now. They've lost the Armani Rogers, who you guys saw in the first half of the game last year, and he got hurt right at the end of the first half and didn't play. That he's a big, I mean, can you look at it from their perspective of losing a playmaker like that and what they went through this past weekend without him and things like that? Can you see why they struggled?
Yeah, for sure. Definitely one of the big keys going in, especially last year, coming out of halftime when he wasn't out there. I mean, the game was won for us already because he wasn't the guy. And so, I mean, I don't know exactly what they're going through, but if we lost Jordan Love, that's all I'm going to say. Leave it at that.
So, but they now have had one more game of a quarterback who maybe doesn't look like he's as much of a runner as that. So, do you think you might have to throw out a lot of the film that you've seen up until now? I mean, it might be a hard deal going in Saturday. You've seen what you're going to get.
Yeah, exactly. We don't know what we're going up against because it's definitely, I don't know if they're going to change their scheme or how they're going to go about it. But I think our main focus is going to be trying to stop the running back right now until that game, until it comes and we see what he can do, the QB can do with his arm.
How's it been on the defensive line? Is there still a lot of rotation going on with you guys playing?
Yeah.
One series, two series, then out of series?
So
still continuing?
Yeah, yep. It's about the next guys, if they see us hands on the hips, that's their key. They're coming in next play. So it's definitely try to keep us fresh out there.
I think we came out and executed how we wanted to, you know, from the jump. Definitely we had a huge help from Tipa with that, you know, pick six on the screenplay. But, you know, I think week in and week out we've been able to establish who we are as an offense, and I think that's just starting fast, you know, whether it is the run game or the pass game. It's just all about execution for us, being able to move the ball and, you know, line up fast and get on hurried on to the next play. And, you know, from there we're able to turn our points.
How difficult do you think it is for defense, the game plan for you guys right now? I mean, I think people expected you guys to come out and throw for a lot of yardage against BYU, but the way the running game asserted itself, I mean, how difficult do you think it is, the game plan for you guys?
I think it is very difficult, especially with our tempo and how we move the ball. You know, we have, you know, good enough athletes on the outside around Jordan that, you know, get defenses tired, you know, trying to cover us downfield, whether it is a man or zone coverage. So I think we hold up our end in the pass game, and then that allows the guys, big guys up front, you know, and the running backs to do their thing.
Jalen, coach is always talking about how everyone on this team is going to block, and they're going to be good blockers. And it seems like that's something you've done really well this season. How much pride do you take in not only being able to catch the ball and make a big play, but to be able to block and set up for your teammates?
I actually think I could have been better last game blocking, but I take huge pride in it, you know. And, you know, not just catching the ball, but I feed off of guys, you know, making big plays. So I love when I get to see Darwin and, you know, Gerald and, you know, Toro, whatever guys back there, you know, get to spring a big run, especially off me doing my job. That's just simply what I do, just do my job in the blocking game. And then, you know, I trust the guys up front that they'll do their job, and then, you know, those big plays spring.
Were the you caught like three early passes in the game that were big plays? Were they all similar type plays, or do you run certain routes, or are you running because of what you see defensively there, or what?
Yeah, there are, you know, little gimmicks built in each play that, you know, different coverages have to recognize, and different, you know, formation that the defense are different things defense are trying to get into based off of our formation. So, you know, there's a lot of things into each play, but I guess they are kind of similar in some ways in the first half. You know, just quick game things, and then, you know, eventually we get to down the field throws.
Is it in any way helped you to be a receiver to have been a quarterback before?
I would say, yeah, just when you're initially recognizing coverage. But, you know, when I'm a receiver, I'm thinking like a receiver. You know, how am I going to release off the line? What am I expecting from the DB? You know, just sinking my – it's everything, just technique-wise into as far as routes. But definitely, you know, having that quarterback background, just being able to see coverage, what defense they're trying to shift into. And then it's just all film. You know, you don't really have to have the quarterback background. If you watch enough film, like, you'll know what the defense is trying to do against you, and just game plan that week and how they – treat you based on different formations.
Tell me about moving in here to Utah State in your situation. I know you looked at maybe some other places, and there might have been some other places you could have gone. Tell us why here, and then what it's been like to move into a program like this compared to, obviously, we think of USC as one of the big programs in the country. Tell us what that's like.
It's just one word, simply, is just my family. You know, they weighed a big option in where I decided I was going to go to school, you know, coming out of high school, and then, you know, things didn't work out how we wanted it to, and then just sat down with my family and decided, you know, what would be the best option for this last go-around. And my mother and father felt great about Coach Wells and the staff we have here, and, you know, just the plan. I felt great about the plan they have for the team and, you know, the guys they had coming back and just the experience. And, you know, then eventually I got to get around the camaraderie once I came on the visit. So I just saw how close-knit everybody was, and I feel like this is the right place for me.
You fit in. It was easy to fit in?
Most definitely, yeah.
Can you talk about that opening scoring drive in the second half, your six-yard catch to go from 14 to 21-point lead? How big of a knockout punch was that to BYU's defense to know that it's going to be a long night, even in the second half, for you, for them to even stop you?
I think it was huge, you know, because just for us to still be executing the way we were as an offense, I think that is critical in the game, you know, because the defense were holding up there in the whole first half and in the second half. So they played a big part in us being able to do what we were able to do. And, you know, I think it's a long night for D coordinators and head coaches once they, you know, they try to throw the whole kitchen table at you, but you're just still executing even with, you know, negative plays. You're still able to find your way out of that and, you know, still stay together as an offense and put points on the board.
How memorable was that locker room after the game?
It was definitely memorable for me. You know, I'm 1-0 against BYU, so I got to see how excited, especially Quinn. He was super excited. So I got to see how excited the guys were. And, you know, even the coaches, you know, the coaches were happy. And, you know, Coach Wells was saying that the whole week, you know, it's a lot of pride with that game. And, you know, we were one of the teams to do it in 44 years to beat them twice. So it was a huge win.
It's like beating UCLA. if you're USC. Mm-hmm. See, that's, yeah. That's how much it means to us.
Yeah, I never lost to those guys in Powder Blue, so I know what it means.
Powder Blue's
yeah. I know what it means to win a rivalry and how impact the team and the fans and the community. So it's great.
I was going to ask, so now do you have a pretty good understanding of what BYU-Utah State, the rivalry, means now compared to before?
I had an understanding because, you know, before when I was out here in May, you know, I would just watch old games from last year. And, you know, you could tell when the stands were full how important the game is. So, you know, once BYU came here last year in all white, just the flow of the game, you know, the crazy plays and how excited the guys were, how hard they were working, just, you know, fight for that win. You can really tell which ones are the big games.
Yeah, and this game was a little more even as far as time of possession goes compared to some of the other ones. But mm-hmm. With how fast you guys run, do you see defensive backs just panting the whole game? And, I mean, how tired do you guys get?
Oh, yeah.
The pace you play at?
You definitely notice it. You know, you'll see, like Chris said, once the D-line puts their hands on their hips, you know, you got them right where you want them. So, you know, we had a couple of their guys, you know, running, trying to get into formation, you know, standing up while we're ready to snap the ball. And, you know, DB's kind of confused. You'll see them bust coverages sometimes once you go back and watch film. And, you know, even when you talk about it at halftime. So that just makes you even more excited, makes you even more juice to, you know, get ready for the next play, not even worry about how tired you are.
For Jordan Love, he's been incredibly accurate all year long. What is it like as a receiver to be able to run a route and know that, you know, even if it isn't double coverage or whatever, that he can put a ball in a tight spot for you?
Oh, this is just amazing. You know, it helps you sleep at night because that just means he trusts you that much more, especially if he sees double coverage and he's still trusting you with the ball and with the execution of the play. So, you know, Jordan's a very accurate quarterback, very strong arm, and this just comes from the work that we put in since I've been here since May. You know, we late nights in the indoor, on the practice field, in the stadium, wherever we can, just to get that connection and the camaraderie.
First of all, really proud of our players and our assistant coaches. I thought they did a great job of the preparation throughout the bye week and BYU week. Thought we prepared really well. Thought we had great game plans. And I thought our guys gave great effort and executed it for the most part fairly well. I think there's a pretty good consensus among the coaches and the players that we didn't play our best game on offense or defense, both of them. But it was good enough, and we did play well. I'm not going to take that away from us at all. I thought we were very physical on the front seven on both sides of the ball. Really proud of our guys for that physicality and toughness that they showed. You know, the other thing is I think we did a great job with the turnover margin. Those were the two biggest keys to us for the victory. We were +3 in the turnover margin. And then the key after that maybe had as much to do with the momentum as anything, and that was all three turnovers led to scores. Obviously, Tepa's pick six, but the offense took the other two turnovers, and I don't think you do it on one occasion. You don't do it on a wideout. You do it every single Saturday. There's only six of them in a year. And, you know, we have three more left. You know, the big goal at the big picture is to be undefeated at home. This will be the fourth chance to get to that. But so Saturday is a big crowd. I know there's a lot of Aggie Brotherhood coming back. Team I got a chance to play on, the Vegas Bowl team, the 78 team. So there's a lot of guys that have played here before us that are coming back. So we'll certainly want to play well in front of them. I promise you that. And it'll be a big deal to our players for that. And so, again, I am hopeful that we'll have a great crowd and a loud crowd, and we'll be able to feed off that energy in the stadium. So with that, I'll go ahead and open it up for questions.
Coach, it just seems that you have a team that has more want to play, or I mean, is that an easy way to put it, or they just seem to have upped the ante in their minds? Has that come from them, do you think, as much as from you guys as coaches?
I think a coach-led team can be a good team, and a player-led team can be great. And I think the great teams that we've had around Utah State that I've been fortunate to be a part of as a player, as an assistant, and as a head coach, they have been player-led, not player-run, but player-led, and there's a difference in those two. And I really have been impressed with our captains, with our seniors. These guys, you know, just their demeanor and their willingness to really take our theme of the week or focus of the week and really kind of put it to into motion and put it into play in the locker room. And they have led by their production. Our best players have played very well. And that's, first of all, the first step to being a great leader. But the credit goes to those players.
How many captains do you have?
We have 18.
So, 18.
Yeah, so what we do is it's kind of a captains as well as a player committee. Mm-hmm. And we have 8 seniors, 6 juniors, and 4 sophomores. 18. I know I'm from Oklahoma. I can count. It just took me a minute. But, yeah, so.
Okay. I knew you had. I just didn't know how many captains.
Yeah, and then we rotate the 4 game captains. Yeah. We rotate it around.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, again, most impressive thing to me about Friday's game was just the offensive line and the front 7 on defense. So, I mean, just looking back at that game, who really stood out to you? Who really came to play for you guys in those 2 units?
Everybody that played. I mean, I'd be remiss, you know, I don't, you start singling them out, all I'm going to do is tell you all the starters and all the backups. You know, Alfred Edwards, our starting left tackle, started 5 games at left tackle, goes out the first series, and nobody in the stadium knew it, except his mom and his O-line coach, and me, and the trainers. That's it. That's a testament to the depth we have on the offensive line, the versatility, the job that Steve Farmer's doing, the job that our players are doing. You know, I thought our O-line and D-line played a very good game, probably the best game combined of those two on the season. And I thought Michigan State, we played pretty well up front on both sides.
Speaking of which, Dax Raymond left a little bit early. Can you give any comment on that? Is he done for the season? Or?
No, absolutely not done for the season, but he'll be out for a couple weeks.
What was the locker room like after that game?
It's a pretty good celebration. You know, I mean, it's a rivalry. It's a rival game. It's an in-state rivalry, and I've never shied away from those comments. That's a big deal to those players. It's a big deal to the school. It's a big deal to our alumni. I guess I kind of fit almost every one of those categories. It's a big deal to me. It was a great locker room. Those are things you remember that stuff for a long time. We'll move on. We've already moved on to Vegas. But that game, really, it's exactly what I tried to make it out to be. It's one game, one trophy, and a heck of a lot of pride. So the only thing we got right now is the pride. We've got the trophy for another year. And you know, you really, I think those feelings will come back up in the off season. To be honest with you, you'll remember them. They won't forget them. But yeah, it's a heck of a locker room scene. And I was getting texts from the guys, a lot of the guys on the 2014 team on Saturday and Sunday, and I said locker room was just like it was in 2014. You know, so they don't forget that stuff.
Well, I've got to imagine it's intentional to keep the wagon wheel right out here where everyone can see it every day.
I walk past it every day.
How do you evaluate UNLV with this last game? Because, I mean, they didn't get anything offensively at all with this new quarterback. Do you throw out that game and just figure, hey, they're going to come up with something different with a new quarterback? Or how do you evaluate?
No, I don't think you throw it out because it's evidence on tape. Mm-hmm. It's hard to discard that. You've got schemes that are going to be consistent throughout the first, you know, part of the season, the first 5 games, I guess, for them. And then you're looking at personnel. And so you do a little bit of all that, what they've done in the past, what they could do, you know, coordinator tendencies, you know, things that have had success against our defense. You know, all those kind of things. You just kind of try to take all those things into consideration.
This quarterback obviously is a completely different guy than
right.
Rodgers, right?
Right.
So it has to change the way they play.
Yeah, I mean, and it may change a little bit of the way they call things, too, on offense, you know.
I mean, they finally started to throw the ball a little bit when they were behind, obviously, in the fourth quarter against New Mexico or whatever. Mm-hmm. But I mean, Thomas only carried the ball one time in the first half, but they only had one first down. So, I mean, it's hard to even see much of him in that game or anything, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, the biggest thing is they'll get those guys going. That's a really good coaching staff. I think, you know, you look at To me, you just look at the body of it. That means all of it. The USC game, they played extremely physical and were extremely competitive that whole game. I mean, Arkansas State is a really good football team in Jonesboro. We've been there. I got a lot of respect for Blake. I know Blake Anderson well, and that game comes down to the wire. So this is a good team. I'm sure Saturday didn't go as well as they wanted it to, but I'll promise you they'll come in here. We'll be ready, but they'll be a good team, and they'll have energy and effort, and they're going to play good Saturday.
UNLV has given up some yards this year, but they also fly to the ball. They have 11 sacks. They have a guy with 9 tackles for loss. So how good of a test will this be for your offensive line?
Oh, I mean, you know, they've got talented guys. I just said that in my opening statement. I mean, they've got guys that get your attention really quick. They've got guys that have been active behind the line of scrimmage. They got physical, 2 physical safeties. I mean, really. Yeah, it's going to be the battle of Dalton Bakers this week.
That's right.
They won't play against each other unless they play on special teams.
Yeah.
I haven't looked at it that far yet.
Yeah, he averages more than 10 tackles a game.
Our Dalton Baker doesn't, but our Dalton Baker's played really well. I'm excited for him. He is, as soon as he cleans up a couple of the assignment and maybe alignment, a couple things, he is. We found a spot for him. That's his natural spot, and he's played well at D line for us. And I know Coach Miley's really pleased with him.
Coach, do you remember as a player? I mean, was homecoming any more special at all, or was it just another game? Like, is that something that you even remember playing in homecoming games specifically?
I don't remember who they were. I'd have to look it up in the media guide. Yeah. I think it's maybe honestly a little bit bigger deal now than it was when I played. I don't know.
Well, you'll remind the guys that these former teams are coming back. You'll mention that.
Oh, yeah. I promise you. Yeah, they'll know. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just want to ask you a question about Jordan with him being offensive player of the week. I can't speak today. He didn't pass the ball as much because you ran the ball so well, but he was really efficient. How pleased were you with the efficiency with him and his opportunities?
He played well. He played very well. He was stingy with the football. I thought he made good decisions in the passing game. Threw a couple away. Didn't take sacks. Got us in the right protection. Doesn't throw interceptions. Didn't throw interceptions. And I think he's playing well. He was calm. He was cool in that atmosphere. It's a tough stadium to play in. That's a loud stadium to play in. And it's done some opposing quarterbacks in before. And I thought he and Quinn handled it pretty well with all the communication, being in the shotgun every snap. I thought they handled it pretty well.
You get 223 yards rushing against them. Wisconsin didn't have that many and things like that. How proud are you of that?
Oh, a lot, because I think that, goes back to trying to win the battle in the trenches and being physical. And I think our O-line, our tight ends, did that. I thought both backs ran hard. Gerald and Darwin both ran hard. They got into the secondary, made guys miss in the secondary or jumped over them. So I think, there's a lot that goes around. I thought our receivers blocked pretty well on the perimeter. We could have blocked better if we'd have sustained a couple more blocks. You'd have seen a couple longer touchdown runs. But they're good. BYU is a good team, and I give them credit. I absolutely do. They got a good secondary and they got off blocks. So when you play a good team like that, it's not going to all go perfect. But a lot better rushing performance than we had last year against them.
Coach, your team's, it's one of the better teams in the nation at not allowing sacks. I think just 1 over 1 per game. As someone who's played the position of quarterback, what does that do for quarterback's confidence knowing that they're not going to get hit very often?
It's a great sense of confidence. It really does wonders for a QB's confidence when he feels that. Not allowing sacks, that stat, is really reflective of every single position on offense, to be real honest with you. the obvious one is the offensive line, from a physicality standpoint as well as an identification and a protection standpoint, okay? It's the receivers in terms of their routes, running them correctly and getting open and the timing, not making the quarterback, you know, hang on to the ball longer. The running backs and their routes and protections, they got dual just like the tight ends do. And then obviously the quarterback going through his progression, knowing the, you know, knowing his role within the offense and how Jordan is getting through progressions and reads fairly fast right now. And that's efficient. It's not too quick. He's not getting out of it. I mean, he understands what we're doing. And so you put all that together and you know, you've got to handle pressure. You got to handle max blitz. You've got to handle, you know, drop eight. He's got a lot of things to handle. But, you know, not giving up sacks is really reflective of the whole team, just like taking care of the football is. And we say that on offense all the time. David Yost says it all the time, is ball security is 100% all 11 guys. It's not just the running back or not just the receiver. You know, if we don't make a line call, and we didn't make a line call on one of the goal line short yardage plays, and they bring a guy off the edge and he hits the back clean, you know, that's just as much on the tackle as it is, or the tight end, whoever's on the edge of the O-line, as it is the running back if he coughed up the ball. So it's ball security is everybody.
Coach, you've been incredibly complimentary of your offense, but yet you've also said that, you know, they're not perfect yet. What's something you want to see your offense work on or at least improve upon going, I guess, into conference play?
I think the biggest thing is continuing, and we've done a good job of this, but I think it's continuing to overcome adversity in the middle of a series, is that, you know, a penalty or you know, a negative yardage play or something like that. As you continue to overcome that, that gives you confidence as an offense. This game, we got to play a little bit. You know, we didn't play as well. I'm saying this game, Vegas coming up, we got to play better on first down. We didn't hit any of our deep shots. I think we were 0-for-5 on our passes down the field. That's a little bit on, you know, on several positions. We can certainly coach that better, but, you know, we got to hit downfield shots when they're open. Now your percentage, you know, throwing the ball vertically is typically not real high, but we've got to continue to take shots, and we've got to hit our share of those. We can do a little bit better job of that.